if someone wants to speak in tongues. Now, he has said everyone wants to have a tongue or an interpretation or a revelation. He says, well, if someone wants to speak in tongues, let's have two or three at the most. One at a time, only with an interpretation. So he's saying that when you guys come together, all of you are wanting to speak in tongues, and all of you want to prophesy. He said, let's rein this in a little bit. Let's have two or three of each, and one at a time, because otherwise everybody's trying to talk.
Yeah. Okay, I'm going to call back another time so we can go further. But, of course, I think it is, how is it then, brethren? This is how it should be. And I think what you're saying about the two prophets, that is just a matter of keeping order.
Well, of course it is.
Verse 31, here again,
of course it is. I don't disagree with you. I don't disagree with you. Yeah. Paul is trying to keep order. That's what he's trying to do. But he's trying to keep order by saying only two or three.
But not by limiting it to two, because in verse 31 it says that you may all prophesy one after another, that all may learn and all may be comforted. So to me, Steve, and I'll drop it with this for now, and I'll get back to you another time. I did send you an email and a text, but the spirit of prophecy is the testimony of Jesus. And among mature believers, if we're starting to grow and be mature, the testimony of Jesus is what's going to be going on. Now, all these carnal considerations, yes, it's possible that they could come in and corrupt such a setting, but I'm not thinking about the natural carnal corruption. I'm thinking about what it is that we can do as we come together that that the Word of God tells us and that would benefit everybody. I think the Nicolaitan thing, I believe, you know, the continuation of one or two having almost all the say and do while the great number rest of the people are passive, is that Nicolaitan thing that the Lord hates. It shouldn't be in that order.
Now, when you say the Nicolaitan thing, you're seeing the doctrine of the Nicolaitans as being the division between clergy and laity, which is a popular teaching in some churches. The early church fathers said the Nicolaitan heresy had nothing to do with that. And, the Nicolaitan teaching is named after Nicholas, according to Irenaeus and other church fathers. Several church fathers made reference to the Nicolaitans. They said they were the followers of Nicholas, who was actually one of the deacons in Acts chapter 6, who apparently must have backslidden or something, because there were heretics that saw themselves as his followers who were teaching Gnostic-type errors. Now, I realize that there's a very popular teaching, and I've heard it many times myself, that the doctrine of the Nicolaitans is a reference to a division between clergy and laity. Well, I don't believe in division between clergy and laity, but I'm not going to make up a meaning of a word in order to support my views on this. They say, well, Nicolaitan comes from the two words nikos and laos, and nikos means to conquer, and laos means the people. So they say, oh, the conquest of the people, that must mean some few in the church are conquering the others by becoming clergy. Well, that's a very large leap, since the word doesn't say anything about clergy or laity, and frankly, no church father ever saw that as the meaning of it. So you're making a great deal about a theory, about the meaning of the Nicolaitans, that I don't even accept the theory. More than that, I think you're trying to defend a cultural means of gathering, which many charismatic people have, which goes against what Paul's saying, and so you're trying to say, well, he doesn't mean what he actually said, and you're trying to find fault with me for it, because I'm simply saying what he said. I'm saying nothing more than what's in the passage. I'm saying that Paul starts out by saying the way things are, and then he says the way they should be. And he starts out telling what the way things are by saying, how is it? It's like this when you come together. How should it be? Well, everything should be done to edify others. Prophets and speakers in tongues should speak one at a time. Let's limit it to two or three of each in the meeting. And, I mean, sure, he says you may all speak, you may all prophesy. He means all two or three of you in that meeting can prophesy. You don't have to do it all at once. And frankly, if you want to wait to another meeting, others can prophesy too. Paul, yeah, I mean, you have a picture in your mind, which is probably based on a cultural thing in the charismatic movement you're in, that doesn't let you see what Paul is saying, in my opinion. That's just my take. I don't know you, but from what you've said, it sounds to me like you're trying to defend something from this passage that the passage itself does not defend. And frankly, if Paul did have in mind the kind of meetings that you're talking about, this would be the place he'd say so, because you don't find him talking about these kind of specifics elsewhere in his writings. So I think you're reading into things. I'm not trying to. I mean, I believe in speaking in tongues. I believe in prophecy. I believe in their function in the church. I just believe they should be functioning in a scriptural way. Whenever people aren't doing it in a scriptural way, I believe it can bring a reproach on Christ. As Paul himself said, it'll look like you're all mad. You know, that's what Paul said later in this whole chapter. I appreciate your call. Let's talk to Alex from St. Paul, Minnesota. Alex, welcome to The Narrow Path. Thanks for calling.
Hi there, Steve. I hope you're doing pretty well.
Thank you.
So, yeah, of course. In regards to Deuteronomy 22, 25 through 28, I recently heard one of the, there was a King James only guy, and he was trying to draw a distinction between, you know, in the King James, it shows that there's a difference between the individuals, the women in these in these verses. One group in 28, those are consenting women when they're being found with a man. And before, it's non-consensual, and that's why the punishment is death. And then he said the other versions of the Bible, the NIV, ESV, all use wording that indicates that they are being raped because the wording is the same. And I did check, it is the same. It says in the ESV, I think it uses the word seized for all of the scenarios from 25 to 28. So I was just wondering if you knew anything about what the original, you know, Hebrew is saying, what your take on what it's probably trying to illustrate, and, you know, if you could talk about this a little bit.
Okay. Well, in verse 25, it says, but if a man finds a betrothed young woman, whose status, by the way, is in terms of availability, was the same as a married woman, that is not available, in the countryside, and the man forces her and lies with her, then only the man who lay with her shall die. But you shall do nothing to the young woman. There is in the young woman no sin deserving of death. For just as when a man rises against his neighbor and kills him, even so is this matter. In other words, she's a victim of a crime. She's been raped. She's been seized. She's been forced. Even though, you know, she is betrothed, and if she had consented to this, that'd be considered adultery and she's stoned to death. She's given the benefit of the doubt. This happened out in the field where no one was around. The assumption is she may have cried out for help and no one was around, because it says that very thing in verse 27. It says, for he found her in the countryside, and the betrothed young woman cried out, but there was no one to save her. Now, they don't know if she cried out or not, but they're going to give her the benefit of the doubt. I mean, she may have cried out, and since no one can confirm whether she did or not, then they're going to give her the benefit of the doubt. That's always the tendency of the law of Moses, too. Someone's, you know, innocent unless proven guilty. The other scenario then comes in verse 28. If a man finds a young woman who is a virgin, who is not betrothed, and seizes her and lies with her, and they are found out, then the man who lay with her shall give the young woman's father 50 shekels of silver, and she shall be his wife, because he has humbled her. He shall not be permitted to divorce her all his days. Now, in this case, this is a woman who is available for marriage. She's not betrothed. And therefore, the man who deflowers her is required to marry her. Now, I've heard people object to this law because it says, what, a woman has to marry her rapist? A woman wouldn't want to be married to a man who raped her. Well, she doesn't have to if her father won't permit it. There's another passage in Deuteronomy that says if her father absolutely won't permit it, then the man has to pay the father the bride price of virgins and leave, you know, leave her alone. So the woman is not forced to marry him. He is forced to marry her, but her father can say no. This is a penalty not on the woman, but on the man. The woman is not penalized. She's considered to be essentially innocent. But most women in that society, and as hard as it is for modern American women to understand this, they wanted to be married. And a woman who is no longer a virgin, her chances of being considered to be attractive on the marriage market were diminished. Most men wanted to marry a virgin. And once she has been deflowered, she's no longer a virgin through no fault of her own. And therefore, I mean, it's like, okay, you broke it, you bought it, is really the policy. If you deflowered her, you may not have wanted to marry her, but you've got to marry her. You've got to make an honest woman of her and of yourself and, you know, take care of her. You can't even divorce her for the rest of your life. Now, under the Jewish law, people could divorce under certain circumstances, but this, it's a penalty to the man. Now, you might say, how could being married to a woman be considered a penalty? Isn't that negative? Well, it could be if it's not a woman you planned to marry. If it's a woman you just wanted to use and discard, well, the fact that you have to now be committed to supporting her and raising her kids and so forth, and being a husband to her, accountable to the rest of society for being a decent guy, well, that's your penalty. Again, you broke it, you bought it. Now, again, the woman is not forced to marry him. If she says to her dad, I don't want to marry him, her dad can say, you can't have my daughter. Now, the problem then is, of course, she's no longer a virgin, and finding her a husband may be a little more difficult, which is why the guy who raped her is required, if she insists upon it, to marry her, because she might otherwise not be married. But the man has to pay her father a penalty, a bride price, to, you know, and then she's left alone. Now, there is another passage that talks about the woman who is betrothed, and she is raped not out in the field. In this case, it says if she's in the field, the betrothed woman, who's not free to marry, that she is not considered to be guilty because it's assumed she was out screaming out for help and no one was around to hear her. But it says in another passage, which I don't have at my fingertips, that if it was in town when this happened, then she will be put to death too because she could have cried out for help and didn't. The assumption is if she's in a populated area and this event took place and she didn't call out for help, then it was consensual. But if no one knows if it was consensual or not, but it was out in the field and she might have called for help, she's given her the benefit of the doubt that she did. So I don't understand what the objection is here.
Oh, no, yeah, that answered that perfectly. I that makes a lot of sense. Do you happen to know what verse it talks about he needs the father with the father's approval?
If I was at home with my ordinary Bible, I have it written in the margins, and I'm on the road and I have a Bible with nothing written in the margins, not even cross references in this Bible. So I believe it's actually in Exodus where that, I think it's in Exodus maybe. In the section, chapters 21 through 23, I think that that's what's usually called the Book of the Covenant, right after the Ten Commandments. Mm-hmm. I think it's in that body of literature. But my wife, who is in the room, is likely to find out.
Great. All right. Well, thank you so much for the answer, Steve. I appreciate it.
The passage. So.
All right. I'll take a look at it. Thank you so much. You have a good one.
Okay. God bless you. Thanks for your call.
God bless.
Okay, Rez from San Francisco, California. Welcome to The Narrow Path. Hello? Going once, going twice? I think he hung up. Okay, let's talk to Don from Vancouver, Washington. Don, welcome to The Narrow Path.
Hi, Steve. Hey, I appreciate the program as always. Thank you very much. Sure. And okay, my question is there any reason that we couldn't see the triumphal entry of Jesus into Jerusalem as a foreshadowing of the rapture? So the conquering king, he's coming to the kingdom. The people go out and meet him and escort him back to the kingdom. So is there any reason you can think of that couldn't be a foreshadowing of the rapture?
Well, could we see this as that? I guess it's entirely possible to see this or that. I mean, obviously, you're seeing it as a possibility. People can see many things in the Bible if it strikes them as true, but it doesn't mean that the Bible teaches that. I don't think I would say that, although I understand what you're saying, that when we are raptured, we meet the Lord in the air and return with him. When Jesus was coming into Jerusalem, apparently these people came out from the city to greet him and returned with him, so it'd be kind of the same kind of motion, the greeting of the king as he comes. So, you know, I wouldn't say you're wrong, and you may be, in fact, very right. It may be that this is, that God himself sees this as sort of a foreglimpse of our meeting Jesus when he comes the second time, just as these people went when he came the first time. I don't see enough reason to, let's just say if I was teaching the passage and considered making that point, I would have to say I don't see enough basis for me to make that comparison. But on the other hand, I don't see any reason that a person couldn't suggest that as a consideration.
Okay, yeah, I came across it, and I was reading and thinking about the it, and it seemed to make some sense, at least. But once again, I'm not quite sure of that. And okay, well, thank you very much.
Well, there certainly is a parallel insofar as you've described it. There's that parallel. Whether it's intended to be like a type and antitype, I don't know. You know, I mean, that many things that happen in the Bible are types and shadows of other things that happen later. But there's also things that look like they might be types, but we don't have any biblical authority for saying they're types. And in that case, they might be or they might not be. And, you know, I would say if I teach a passage, if the Bible itself identifies something as a type of something else, I'll confidently present that. If I think something looks kind of like a type of something else, I, you know, depending on how much it looks like it, I might suggest, yeah, this could be a type that the Bible doesn't authorize our saying so, but it could be. It's an edifying way to look at it. And that's how I would probably take that example if I had that in my mind and I was teaching that passage.
Okay, well, thank you very much.
All right, Don, good to hear from you, brother.
Thank you. Bye-bye.
God bless. Bye-bye now. Okay, Dennis from Phoenix, Arizona. Welcome to the Narrow
Hello?
Path. Hi.
Hi, Steve?
Mm-hmm.
Hi there. I'm calling you from Phoenix. This is my first time calling in. I was calling at the behest of a friend of mine that we've been, since I woke up this morning, I haven't had breakfast or coffee, and we've been discussing scripture pretty much all morning and into the afternoon.
That's pretty excessive if you don't even drink coffee.
What's that?
I said that's pretty obsessive if you don't even drink coffee. It almost sounds unhealthy.
I know. I'm missing out. But anyways, thank you for taking my call.
Yeah.
And there was two of the three other phone calls I wanted to address on something, but my friend wants me to ask the first question before going to, because there was, I disagree with you on the thing with the Nicolaitans, but if we have time, we'll save that for after. He wants me to address this issue about the resurrection of Jesus being on Sunday, which I do not believe. I believe he rose shortly before the Sabbath ended. And by the way, I am a Sabbatarian. I keep the Sabbath. I'm not a Seventh-day Adventist. I've expressed to him that according to the calculated Hebrew calendar, and I know the Catholics say that he was crucified in 33 A.D., but it was really 30 A.D., and he died on the Passover, which is rightly so, because that's how God does things. I believe he does things correctly and on time. And he died on a Wednesday afternoon, which would fulfill, or he would satisfy what he told the Pharisees regarding, give us a sign on who you are. And he said, well, no sign is going to be given to an evil and adulterous generation except for the sign of Jonah, which is the 3 days and the three nights. So he and I were having a little bit of discussion. Well, how do we know that there's, 12 hours in a day and all that? Well, John 11 expressively, Jesus expressively says how many hours and, there are in a day. And also in Genesis 2, the evening and the morning were the first day. So
yeah, let me interrupt you here for a second because I don't want to cut you off, but I have to take a hard break here.
Okay.
I'll come back to you after we take this break. So stay on the line and we'll talk to you. You're listening to the Narrow Path radio broadcast. We have another half hour coming up, but at this point, we always let our listeners know that we are a listener-supported ministry. You may not have noticed there have been no commercial breaks the first half hour. There's none in the second half hour either. We have no sponsors. If you'd like to help us stay on the air, you can write to us. The address is The Narrow Path, P.O. Box 1730, Temecula, California, 92593. You can also go to our website, thenarrowpath.com. Everything there is free, but you can donate if you wish at thenarrowpath.com. I'll be back in 30 seconds. Don't go away.
Small is the gate and narrow is the path that leads to life. We're proud to welcome you to The Narrow Path with Steve Gregg. Steve has nothing to sell you today, but everything to give you. When today's radio show is over, we invite you to visit thenarrowpath.com, where you'll find topical audio teachings, blog articles, verse-by-verse teachings, and the archives of all the radio shows. Study, learn, and enjoy. We thank you for supporting the listener-supported Narrow Path with Steve Gregg.
Thank you.
Welcome back to the Narrow Path Radio broadcast. My name is Steve Gregg, and we're live for another half hour taking your calls. The lines are full. I'll give you the phone number, but you may not get through before the end of the day. If you try later, the line might be open. The number is 844-484-5737. And once again, I'm speaking in Kansas City tonight. If you're in the area, you might want to join us. You can go to our website, thenarrowpath.com, and look under announcements. You'll find the time and place of that gathering. Before our break, we were talking to Dennis from Phoenix, Arizona, who introduced himself as a Sabbatarian, but not a Seventh-day Adventist. And his interest is in the timing, apparently, of Jesus' death and resurrection. And so I'm going to come back to you now, Dennis, and let you please state your question or your case or whatever it is you're hoping to get across.
Okay, well, basically, you know, I've been talking to a friend of mine, and he's an evangelical, and so he doesn't know too much about the matter as far as, you know, from the church that he goes to. I guess he hasn't gotten deep in delving into that. I have looked at this for many, many years, and from Scripture, showing that Jesus did, in fact, was in the grave 3 days and three nights. I know in Orthodox Christendom, it is greatly expounded that he was crucified on a Friday because of the weekly Sabbath being the next day, and then he rose on Orthodox Christendom calls the Easter Sunday morning resurrection. However, okay, he was already risen, but the fact is, from what the Scripture teaches, and from I can't find anywhere where the gospel accounts disprove it, that he died on a Wednesday afternoon in that year 30 AD, because that was the day of the Passover, and he was in the grave 3 days and three nights, just as he told the Pharisees. And it had to be so because, you know, otherwise he would be a false Messiah and he wouldn't be our Savior. So I told my buddy that, and so he says, would you call in and talk to this guy about that and get his perspective? I said, sure, I'd be glad to talk to him. And that's why we're on the phone. So I'd like to hear your...
I'm glad you called, and I'll be glad to get my perspective. First of all, I wonder, why is this particularly important to you? You mentioned his church doesn't emphasize these things. I can't imagine why a church would care to do so. Why is it such an important matter to you what day Jesus died or rose again?
Well, Orthodox Christendom celebrates Easter, correct?
Well, I don't, but I mean, no, why is this important to you?
Well, because if the world is celebrating a Friday crucifixion to a Sunday, that's only two nights and one full day.
I understand,
whereas
but why?
Jesus told the Pharisees well, it matters because it matters to God. Just like in my perspective on the fourth commandment, it matters which day to worship God, the fourth commandment, remember the Sabbath. And it's the only commandment that doesn't say thou shalt not, it says remember. So, but that's a subject for another
yes, it is.
Another day.
Yes, it is. So I'm understanding, okay, here's the thing. I may be have a very different set of values perhaps than you do. I don't care if Jesus was crucified on Wednesday, Thursday, or Friday, and I don't care whether he rose Saturday night or Sunday morning. And, you know, if somebody said under me for years, they wouldn't find me focusing on that either, because I can't imagine why that would make a difference. The fact that Jesus died for our sins on the cross is extremely important. That he rose from the dead is equally important. What days of the week it was is not important to me. But see, you're a Sabbatarian, and that means that days are important to you. They're not important to me. So we're kind of starting with a different set of priorities. But I guess what I'd say is, even if you're right, I could hardly become interested, but you wanted my perspective on it. So I'll say this knowing that, let's just say you could prove yourself right. Fine. That's fine with me. However, there are three times that Jesus said he would rise on the third day. And Paul in 1 Corinthians 15 said that Jesus rose on the third day. If Jesus was literally 3 days and three nights in the grave and then he rose, that would seemingly be the fourth day. He'd rise on the fourth day. If he's a full 24 hours times three in the grave, that leaves the next 24 hours, which is the fourth day. And so I'm inclined to believe that when Jesus said he rose the third day and when Paul said he rose the third day, that that's literally true. But the contradictory statement that's found in Matthew 12:40, where Jesus said, as Jonah was 3 days and three nights in the belly of the fish, or the whale, he said, so shall the Son of Man be 3 days and three nights in the heart of the earth, that, I think, is using a typical Jewish idiom, which I don't care if he is or not, honestly, but you're concerned about that. So let me just say, it is well known that the Jews, when they would speak of a sequence of days, were willing to take into consideration a portion of a day at either end of that sequence and treat it as a full day and night. They actually call it a day and night. There's not only in the Bible, external to the Bible, archaeologists have found examples of this being done by the Jews, that they'd speak of a period of days where it might be, let's just say there's 3 days and then a bit of a day before the first and a bit of a day after the third. They'd call it 5 days and five nights. That's just how they spoke. I can't excuse them for using that idiom, but that's what they did. And Jesus was a Jew speaking to Jews. So I believe when he said 3 days and three nights to the Jewish hearer, that would communicate at least parts of 3 days. It could be literally 3 days and three nights if we had no reason to doubt it, but it wouldn't have to be. In the Jewish idiom, it would not be necessarily understood to be literally 3 days and three nights. So if it turned out that Jesus was crucified, let's say on Friday and rose Sunday, and it's true, that doesn't make three literal days and three nights. It doesn't make Jesus a false prophet. It makes him a Jewish prophet, speaking in Jewish terms. If you don't speak in Jewish terms, and you insist that Jesus must speak in Gentile terms that you're familiar with, and on the basis of the fact that he didn't do so, you call him a false prophet, I think that's a problem you've got. But honestly, there's only that one time that the term 3 days and three nights is even used in that statement, and then multiple times we're told he rose on the third day, which, to my mind, makes me think 3 days and three nights is not necessarily literal, and certainly the Jews wouldn't require it to be literal who heard him. Now, again, this is not a big issue to me. If he was crucified Wednesday, it doesn't bother me because I'm not really into days and months and, you know, sacred calendars. And in that respect, I may differ from many other evangelicals, but I've just never, to me, you know, Paul said in Romans 14, one man esteems one day above another, another man esteems every day alike. Now, it's quite clear that Paul is the one on the side of esteeming every day alike. Why do I know that? Because he said, let everyone be fully persuaded in his own mind. If Paul thought that the ones who were, that they were right, who thought you have to esteem one day above another, then he would be intolerant to those who esteemed every day alike. So the fact that he gave liberty to do it either way means that Paul did not believe that you have to keep one day above another. Now, you and I would have a long discussion, I'm sure, about the Sabbath, but that's not the thing you called about. My lines are full with other callers. But I will give you the last word on the points I made. So go ahead.
Okay, well, I disagree with you wholeheartedly on some aspects, but as far as, look, there's a lot of difficult scriptures written by Paul that I believe Orthodox Christendom doesn't fully understand. If you look at 2 Peter 3:16, Peter even said so himself. Those things that Paul mentions about a day above another, that's another subject. I have some knowledge on that too, but I can't delve with you, Steve, when there's other callers on the line and other things. But at least you gave me your perspective on that, and that's all I could say for right now, because, you know, time is of the essence and you've got all these other callers, but I could expound deeper on it, but we just don't have the time. Unless you want to come to Phoenix and I'll take you out to eat, we can go have a cup of coffee and some breakfast, I'll be glad to talk to you.
Okay, I can't guarantee the coffee and the breakfast, but I'll be in Phoenix in a couple of weeks.
Sounds good.
Okay.
Where are you going to be at?
I forget. A number of places. Go to thenarrowpath.com.
Yeah.
And I think I'm going to be there 3 days and three nights, if I'm not mistaken.
Okay. Well, I don't know how you came up from Wednesday to Saturday being four days. I count only 3 days and three nights, so I don't know how you got to four, right. But...
Well, no, because between Wednesday and Saturday are only 3 days. What I'm saying is Jesus said he's going to rise on the third day, which...
He did. He rose shortly before the Sabbath ended at twilight. There's two, in the Hebrew, there's Ba'erev and
Ba'harim. Hang on, Dennis.
So.
Dennis, I'm going to take your word on that.
Okay.
Thank
all
you.
Right, then. Thank you. Bye.
God bless. Bye now. Okay, we're going to talk next to Mo from Buckeye, Arizona. What do you know? That's where we're going to be.
Hey.
Hi, Mo.
Hey, Steve. How's it going? Thank you for taking my call. Hey, I got a crazy question for you. My brother-in-law has just come to know the Lord. He's kind of caught up in some of these different theories, and I'm not sure if you've heard of the Mandela effect.
Sure have.
But he's telling me that different passages in the Bible are changing. Like he says that Easter is now in the Bible. He says that the lion will lay down
with
the lamb has changed. I just wondered your thoughts on that and how would someone like me approach him. The only thing I could come up with was, you know, we need to hide the word of God in our heart that we may not sin against God. I just wondered your thoughts on that.
Could I ask you how old he is?
Yeah, he is. He's in his 40s.
Okay. Okay, here's the reason I asked. I'm almost 70, and I remember the King James Version that I grew up with never saying the lion shall lay down with the lamb. It always said the wolf will lie down with the lamb. And so does, if I pull the King James off my shelf right now and look, it still says that. The Mandela effect is a conspiracy theory, a demonic conspiracy theory, that something has happened that has released demons into our world in great numbers. And one of the most horrendous things they could think of to do to damage the kingdom of God was to change a few verses in the King James Version. And which not many people read anymore anyway, and the verses that they changed don't have any impact on anything. So I would think if I was a demon wanting to do harm to the kingdom of God, I'd do something a little more, I don't know, a little more damaging than that. What they believe is that the King James Version Bible's wording has been magically changed on the page. They actually believe that if you had a King James Version on your shelf before this happened, and you pulled that same Bible off the shelf right now and looked at it, the words have changed in it magically. And the example they always give is the lion shall lay down with the lamb over in Isaiah 11, which is also found in Isaiah 65. And they're influenced by popular pictures on Christmas cards, of course. They say that when they were younger, they read that passage and it said the lion shall lay down with the lamb. Where, in fact, if you look at it now, it says the wolf shall lay down with the lamb. And so they say, see, there's magic here, demonic magic. And boy, did the demons get a lot of mileage out of this one. Because just think, what if they did change the lion lay down with the lamb to the wolf lay down with the lamb? Well, that compromises the whole of Christianity, doesn't it?
Yeah.
It makes no difference whatsoever. If demons are going to come and change the Bible, they might change like something about like that Jesus is Lord, and say maybe he's not Lord or something like that. I don't know why they would change the name of the predator that lies down with the lamb.
Mm-hmm.
Why would they do that? And they didn't. Because I actually read the King James Version almost exclusively 60 years ago, and up until about 1983 or so, I almost used exclusively the King James Version of the Bible. I knew that passage very well, and it never said the lion shall lay down with the lamb.
Okay.
As far as the presence of the word Easter in the King James, it's always been there, too. Easter has always been there, too. In the Greek, it's the Passover. But it's when Paul said he had to get to Jerusalem by Easter. The King James always said that, but it should say Passover. The newer versions will say Passover.
Okay. Well, I appreciate your insight. I had asked a couple of pastors, and they didn't really want to touch it, and so you always have sound advice, so thank you so much. I appreciate it. I know that was kind of a strange call, but thank you so much.
All right. Well, it's good to hear you from you, and I'm going to be in Buckeye again in a couple of weeks. Yeah, check it out at our website.
I heard that. I may have to swing by and see it. Thank you so much, Steve.
Okay, great. Hear it from you, brother.
All right. Bye-bye. God bless you, sir.
You too. Bye now. Okay, Rez from San Francisco, who got cut off last time, is back. Hi, Rez.
Hey, Steve, how you doing? Thanks for taking my call. Sorry about earlier. I just had a question for you. It seems, your opinion, it seems to me right now in the world, a lot of people don't have a lot of discipline with how they're treating their bodies, and maybe even sexual immorality and fornication, this kind of a thing. And so I was wondering if you thought that maybe people have misinterpreted what Jesus said when he said he was without sin, cast the first stone, and maybe they've misinterpreted Jesus's beliefs about just love, because it seems to me that a lot of the Old Testament, if the world still followed a lot of the Old Testament where people were to be put to death for certain things, that maybe people would not be doing the things that they're doing, because you see this in like Islamic countries.
So let me ask you, could you summarize that into a succinct question?
So do you think that if people followed the Old Testament more than just that the world would not be in the condition that it's in with just free love, pornography, all sorts of things that are kind of depraved?
Well, if people followed the Old Testament better, it'd be a better world, that's for sure. In fact, if Israel had followed the Old Testament better, they would have been a better nation than they were. God gave good laws, and he said so many times, he said his laws were perfectly just, they're the best laws. God told Israel in Deuteronomy, you know, do not forget to keep these laws, because they are your boast before all the nations who will see and say, well, what nation has such a great God as this who gives his people such good laws and so forth. The Bible makes it very clear that the laws God gave Israel are very just, and certainly any society that follows just laws is going to be better than a society that follows unjust laws. And so if your question is, would we be better off if everyone followed the Old Testament? Probably, but we wouldn't be necessarily Christian, because the Old Testament's not, it doesn't describe Christianity. It does describe morality. And insofar as a society ought to be moral, I think it'd be great if the morality of the Old Testament was followed. Of course, you're talking about, you know, capital punishment, though, for people who do the wrong things. There were something like about 30 sins or crimes in the Old Testament that had capital punishment attached to them. And some people think, oh, that's barbaric. How could they have that? Well, we don't actually read of very many of those being enforced. And it might be because the fact there was capital punishment prevented people from doing those things. I'm not, I wouldn't be offended if God said, you know, whoever wears blue shoes should be stoned to death. Because the truth is, nobody has to wear blue shoes. And if I lived in a society where that was the law, I would not be afraid that I'd be stoned to death. I just wouldn't wear blue shoes. Now, if the society says you commit adultery, you'll be stoned to death. You commit homosexual acts, you'll be stoned to death. You kidnap someone, you'll be stoned to death. If you worship an idol, you'll be stoned to death. If you gather sticks on the Sabbath, you'll be stoned to death. I mean, guess what? If you strike your parents, you'll be stoned to death. If you curse your parents, you'll be stoned to death. Those are all some of the laws that there were. If you practice witchcraft, you know, I could live in a society that and not be afraid in the least of being stoned to death, as long as I knew the list. If I knew the things that would get me stoned to death, I simply wouldn't do them, because when God made such laws, he never placed a penalty on some act that people were obligated to do. For example, if you breathe, you get 30 lashes. Well, then that'd be an unjust law. But he says, if you step over this line here, you'll be stoned to death. Well, there's nothing unjust about that, since nobody has to do it. Nobody has to bring that on themselves. Everyone could obey. So I'm not really as alarmed as some people are about the death penalty. I got a feeling it kept a lot of kids from striking their parents or from cursing their parents or from doing things. And then when people actually did a lot of those things, when Israel was apostate and they actually did worship idols and commit adultery, it wasn't even enforced. So I don't know if having those laws now would make a better society or not. I don't know that people would keep them any better than Israel did. What will make a better society is for people to have a heart that fears God and desires to please him. And there's every reason that a person should. I mean, what in the world would be a reason not to do that? I can't even imagine what if there's a God out there. Now, I realize some people don't believe there's a God. That would be a different situation for them. But those who believe there's a God, which makes up the vast majority of human beings on the planet, if they thought, you know, pleasing God is really a smart thing to do. Fearing God is a really smart thing to do. Obeying God, that's a really smart thing to do. And it's not really hard unless you just want to be evil, because God didn't forbid anything that's good. He only forbids things that are evil. So I would think only a person who wants to be evil would actually find it difficult to agree to fear God and obey him. I'm not saying we obey perfectly. I'm just saying that as a habit, people ought to want to obey God. And if they don't, I don't quite understand what motivates them, what they're thinking. But I don't think that the imposition of the Jewish law on modern society would necessarily produce a better society. It might. There might be some people who wouldn't commit crime. I do think that law enforcement is good. And, right now we have people who do capital crimes and they walk instead of being punished. And I think that does lead to, more prevalent crime, when they know there's no penalties. I don't know that the death penalty should be imposed on as many things as they were in the Bible. But again, if it was, nobody could complain because they don't have to do the things that the death penalty is. Right now, I could get a very big and expensive traffic ticket if I drive 100 miles an hour on the freeway. I wish I didn't have to be restricted, but I live in a world where that's restricted, and so I won't do it because I don't want the fine. And, that's what law and penalties are about, to let people know what they can get away with and what they can't, and let them decide whether they want to, do the wrong thing and take the penalty or not. But unfortunately, there's a lot of people who think, well, I want to do the wrong thing, and I don't want to get the penalty, but I think I'll get away with it. So I think you're going to always have that number of people out there. I don't see the solution for the world's problems as imposing Jewish law on people. I think people need their hearts changed, because if their hearts are not changed, then they'll always find ways to weasel out of the law. They'll always convince themselves they can get away with it. They'll lie about it and so forth. And it'll make a lot of people less honest than they are. So I just think laws should be just. And I think that a lot of things God said to Israel in the Old Testament reflect a justice standard that all societies would do well to follow. But to say they would do well to follow doesn't mean they would. And it doesn't mean the world would be a better place unless more people turned to God sincerely and had a change of heart. At least that's my thoughts on that question. I don't know if I'm right or not. Okay, we have a call here from AK in Arkansas. And I think I have some friends of yours here in the room with me. AK, hi. Welcome to The Narrow Path.
Thanks, Steve, for having me on. All right, here's my question. So we understand the Bible talks about the Holy Spirit dwelling in us. We are the temple of God. Well, I want to hear you explain your view on what this means. If the Holy Spirit is in us, what is he doing? If he's speaking to us, leading us, how does he do that? I mean, is it inner voices, feelings? I want to hear your view on this.
So your question has mostly to do with how does the Holy Spirit lead us? Because actually, if you ask what happens to us or what's our life like in the Holy Spirit, you're asking for a summary of the whole New Testament message about being a Christian. Because being a Christian is to be animated by the Spirit of Christ, to possess the Spirit of Christ, to be the habitation of God through the Spirit. And virtually everything in the New Testament describes some aspect of that. But if you're asking how does God lead, that is... I don't hear voices in my head, I'll tell you that. I trust that I'm led by the Spirit, because the Bible says as many as are led by the Spirit of God are the children of God, or the sons of God, in Romans chapter 8. And I believe I'm the son of God, and I believe I'm led by the Spirit of God. But it's not generally speaking through voices in my head. Though I will say this, there have been times when I won't say I heard a voice in my head exactly, but I've received, I don't know, mental direction that, that was fairly specific, as if someone had spoken it in my head. But that's not all the time. In fact, it's not even most of the time. God leads us a number of ways. One way, and I think perhaps a very important way, is through the Bible. The Holy Spirit inspired the Bible, and the instructions in it there are, therefore, the instructions of the Holy Spirit. If I'm led by the Spirit, that would suggest I'm following his instructions, and I find those in the Bible for almost everything I need to make decisions about. That is to say, everything that has an ethical or a moral, taint to it, I can usually make a decision based on what the Holy Spirit said in the Word of God. Now, in addition to that, I do believe that the Holy Spirit can speak in any way that he ever has spoken to people. And we know in the Old Testament and the New, sometimes people had dreams, sometimes people had visions, sometimes an angel came. Sometimes, they saw, they heard the voice of God or something from their head, or even from heaven a few times. I believe God can do any of that, but I believe it was exceptional in biblical times and equally exceptional in our times. When we read the book of Acts or even the Old Testament, when we read, God's dealing with Moses or with, Samuel or with Elijah or Elisha or with Paul or Peter, we're seeing continual supernatural phenomena going on, but we don't read about it happening all the time. We read about the times when God was doing something pretty special. I believe God still does special things, and he can speak in those ways today if he wants to. But actually, I think that since the Holy Spirit has spoken through the Scripture, that's a pretty reliable guide as to what the mind of the Spirit is. And that's what I would follow more often, anytime I can. I also think that wisdom is a means of guidance according to Scripture. So we've got the Bible, we've got wisdom, and we've also got whatever way God may want to speak otherwise, but those are fairly exceptional, usually. Hey, I'm out of time. I wish I wasn't. You've been listening to The Narrow Path radio broadcast. Our website is thenarrowpath.com. Thanks for joining us. Let's talk again tomorrow. God bless.